From Washington, D.C., this is Middle East Focus.
Hello, and welcome to Middle East Focus, a weekly podcast on regional affairs and U.S. policy, produced by the Middle East Institute in Washington, D.C. I'm Alistair Taylor, MEI's Editor-in-Chief. On today's program, we'll be talking about the resurgence of the Islamic State, or ISIS, in Syria and Iraq. This episode is the first in a several-part series looking at where the terrorist group stands today and its international footprint 10 years on from the founding of the 87-country global coalition to defeat ISIS. The broader international picture is mixed, but as we'll discuss on today's episode, the trend lines in Syria in particular are deeply concerning. You can subscribe to Middle East Focus on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and other podcast providers. Joining us today to help make sense of things is Charles Lister. Charles is a senior fellow at MEI and the director of its Syria and Countering Terrorism and Extremism programs. He's also the author of several books on Syria and ISIS and the founder of the new newsletter, Syria Weekly. Charles, welcome back to the program, and thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Alistair.
We've got a lot to get through, so let's dive right in. To start off with, can you give our listeners a sort of brief overview of where things stand with ISIS and Syria and Iraq? What's the state of play right now, roughly 5.5 years on from the defeat of its territorial caliphate?
Yeah, so I mean, that's it. In good context, scene setting there is, you know, five and a half years since the territorial defeat, 10 years since its proclamation of a caliphate. A lot has changed. Obviously, the organization is a shadow of its former self, the kind of enormous army that we got used to in 2014 and 2015 is obviously no longer there. The group has struggled on Iraqi soil, thanks in large part to coalition pressure, but also to the fact that the Iraqi security forces have really risen in stature and capability and in number. And so the group's really struggled in Iraq. I think in the first 6 months of 2024, ISIS was behind approximately 35 attacks nationwide in Iraq. But in the same six-month time period, they've conducted 397 attacks in Syria. So completely different picture across Iraq's western border into Syria. And the reason for that, I mean, there are many reasons for that, but mostly it's the fact that Syria remains ridden by chaos, vast ungoverned spaces. ISIS decided in 2016, 3 years before its territorial defeat, to what it called retreat to the desert. That was a publicly announced decision by the group. And that allowed them basically to spend the last several years very slowly rebuilding in the Syrian desert, in the center of the country, which is an area that's on paper controlled by the regime, but very minimally so. And obviously it's a vast expanse of desert and territory very familiar for ISIS, and they've rebuilt themselves. But it's really been in the last 6 months or so that we've seen the results of that slow and methodical rebuilding and a very dramatic resurgence this year.
In an unusual public statement released in mid-July, U.S. Central Command, CENTCOM, said that ISIS was, quote, on pace to more than double the number of attacks it claimed in Syria and Iraq this year compared to 2023. But as you wrote in a piece for MEI just last month, the situation is actually far worse than that, as you kind of alluded to with the figures, largely because ISIS intentionally doesn't claim credit for all of the attacks it carries out. Can you kind of elaborate on that point?
Yeah, so it's a strategy that ISIS has not done almost anywhere else in the world, which is purposefully not claiming responsibility for its attacks. Now, for a while, people thought that it was because ISIS was so weak. It was just simply incapable of kind of, you know, coordinating claims of responsibility, getting them onto the internet. But I think the evidence very much tells us a very different story over the last several years. And it does appear to have been a very clear decision from 2019 until very recently to almost completely stop claiming responsibility for operations. But it's clear to see, for those of us who are monitoring stuff on the ground, that ISIS has been active ever since. So that's part of the story. You know, I wrote the piece in response to the CENTCOM statement also because, first of all, CENTCOM's only metric for measuring ISIS's sort of operational tempo is its claims of responsibility. And that's very misleading because of what we just discussed. But it's even more complicated than that, in that even, you know, my numbers, my monitoring of ISIS attacks, that's still only sort of half of the story. It's very easy if you're, you know, an ISIS fighter in the desert, pick up your AK-47, jump on a motorbike, shoot three rounds at a local checkpoint and drive off and call it an attack. But what we've seen really over the last 9 months is the return of VBIEDs, truck bombs, suicide car bombs. First time we've seen those in years, and we've had three so far in 2024. That speaks to a really significant increase in terms of logistics, capabilities, safe havens, the ability to manufacture those devices and then move them towards an attack area. But we've also seen much more use of IEDs. So again, access to resources, ability to plant those devices without detection all throughout main highways that run through the desert and into eastern Syria. We've seen the group penetrate urban areas, so they're conducting targeted attacks now in all of the main cities throughout northeastern and eastern Syria, in regime-held areas and in SDF-held areas on both sides of the Euphrates. And we've seen their extortion network that it was famous for back in 2014 return in strength. And so in vast swathes of central and eastern Syria, ISIS is now issuing bespoke extortion invoices to local businesses. And they're bespoke in the sense that they appear to know the exact revenues of local businesses. They know how much dentist A in village B is earning per month, and they issue an invoice to tax you on those revenues. So it's not publicized, but it is a, you know, open secret that all local business throughout that vast region of Syria are being regularly extorted by ISIS. And almost daily now we're hearing of ISIS attacks against local businesses and local business owners who are refusing to pay that tax. So that really speaks again to a much more deeply rooted ISIS than what we have seen, you know, in previous years. And that's relatively new and growing quite significantly. And CENTCOM's worried. It's very unusual for them to come out with a statement like that.
Understandably so. I mean, you're painting a very concerning picture for sure. And it comes at a time when I think the attention of policymakers, of analysts, of security officials, both here in Washington and across the region, is kind of understandably strained, is elsewhere. It's focused on the war in Gaza, the tense situation involving Israel, Iran, Hezbollah, among other issues. How is ISIS kind of using that distraction to its advantage?
Well, they've always counted on the idea that our attention spans are short and brief, and it's played upon that many times before and more recently. Even before October the 7th, there was very clear signs, and I and others have written about it, that ISIS was rebuilding, that it was slowly increasing the tempo of its attacks. And there were those of us sort of shouting from the rooftop saying, you know, all the warning signs are here, all the ingredients are in place, we've got to do something about it. But even then, there wasn't and there hasn't been much strategic direction from, you know, the president and on down. So CENTCOM, Special Operations Command, the guys on the ground, they know that this has been building, but ultimately they are still directed by the presidency and by their commander in chief and the strategy, if any, that comes from there. And there hasn't been any for years. And so, yeah, from the top down, there's been a kind of kicking the can down the road approach. You know, so-called, we're doing enough, we're containing the problem. But ultimately, as I've been told privately from, you know, from senior officials in the Defense Department, without that strategic direction, kicking the can down the road is just totally unsustainable. And we're now seeing the consequences of that. But there is another angle here as well, which is since October the 7th and the rise in regional hostilities, we've seen over 220 attacks on U.S. troops in Iraq and Syria. And far more than half of those have been on Syrian soil. And the result of that, U.S. troops haven't been going out of the base, out of their bases, nearly as much as they used to. They're not going out on patrol. They're not getting FaceTime with the local communities. They're not conducting either unilateral, like U.S.-only counterterrorism operations, or as many partnered operations with the SDF. So per CENTCOM statistics, the rate of American and shared operations with the SDF has gone down by 20% in the last 12 months amidst those regional hostilities and attacks. But even worse, the number of ISIS killed and captured in those operations in total have reduced by 75% over the last 12 months. So in other words, the pressure, our ability to pressure ISIS and to contain their ability to resurge has almost vanished over the last 12 months, which obviously has provided ISIS with an opening to resurge much more quickly and much more dramatically than we might otherwise have seen.
One additional kind of complicating variable that we've seen in the past several weeks is the renewal of fighting between regime-linked tribal forces and the U.S.-allied Syrian Democratic Forces in Deir Ezzor. What potential impact could that have on the anti-ISIS campaign, and how does that kind of further complicate an already complicated situation?
Yeah, well, you're right to point out the complexity, because this in and of itself is immensely complicated. It's not, you know, just tribes versus the SDF. It's tribes versus tribes. It's different clans within tribes fighting within each other. There's a regime element here, a regime dynamic. There's an Iranian dynamic. There's a Russian dynamic. In and of itself, it's deeply complex. And it's been coming for a long while. There was a tribal uprising almost exactly a year ago that really gave birth to what we've just seen resume again this August. You know, the US back then in 2023, the last time this happened, comprehensively failed to mediate and to get involved in trying to resolve this issue. And at the time, it was purely tribal. It was all about tribal disenfranchisement with the SDF. This time around, 12 months later, the regime has made really big inroads into actually building ties with the tribes who are opposed to the SDF. So now it's completely different. Now this is a geopolitical conflict. Essentially, it's the regime versus the US played through the tribes. So it has a number of consequences. One is it distracts the US from the ongoing mission against ISIS. Two, it creates clear openings for the likes of ISIS to try to take advantage of the fact that tribes are now at war with each other, and ISIS's greatest tool in its toolbox in Syria and Western Iraq has always been the tribes. And so taking advantage of anger, hostilities, disenfranchisement, political divisions, offers ISIS really good opportunities. And so we're already seeing them take advantage of that. And worse still, or, you know, more importantly still, ISIS is doing what it's always sought to do, which is when there are hostilities somewhere else that it's not directly involved in, they will always try and exacerbate them. And so they have played on tribes on both sides of the river, conducting attacks on both just in the last few weeks amidst this tribal conflict. But at the same time, they have launched a new campaign against the oil industry in regime areas and in SDF areas, which is having a very significant effect on the local economy, which again drives the fact that the tribes rose up in the first place was all about the economy, all about living standards and, the ability to finance stabilization activities and what have you. So you hit the economy, you're exacerbating all of the root causes of the tribal conflict. So they're sowing, they're trying to, you know, rub salt in the wound of an already significant issue.
Before we move on to discuss the Iraqi side of the picture in a bit more detail, there's one final issue I wanted to touch on as well, what's known as the detainee crisis. This is, put briefly for our listeners, the question of what to do with the tens of thousands of foreign ISIS detainees, as well as their families, including children, held in makeshift facilities in northeastern Syria under SDF control. It's a complicated issue. It's one that you've done a lot of work on personally. What's the state of play here? How does that kind of overlap with this, and have there been any significant developments recently?
Well, it tells a very similar story to what we've been talking about ISIS writ large, which is the issue of distraction since October the 7th has been very significant. You know, in 2022, the State Department, with support from external actors, including our own initiative here, made real inroads in convincing governments abroad to repatriate their citizens. We went from a place where most governments outright refused to even consider repatriating women and children to being in a near total consensus that this was something that needed to happen. 2022 into 2023 made a lot of progress in actually repatriating people. And then all of a sudden in the last 9 to 12 months, it hasn't stopped altogether, but it's really slowed down. And that doesn't make any sense except for taking into account the regional hostilities, the regional tensions, the distractions, because the consensus existed to do all of this before. There's another angle here, which is the regional states in the Middle East, who, you know, account for the majority. If you're looking at sort of all areas of the world, the biggest number of people that need to be repatriated who are still there come from Middle Eastern governments, Middle Eastern states. And, you know, prior to the spring of 2023, almost all major regional states had agreed on the need to repatriate. But then they decided to normalize ties with the Assad regime, bring Assad back into the Arab League. And as a result of that, repatriation has become almost impossible because it's not a process that is negotiated and facilitated with the US. It's done through the SDF, which happens to control over a quarter of Syrian territory and maintains a sort of hostile relationship with the Syrian regime. So none of these regional states now are willing to engage the SDF to repatriate their citizens. So that's frozen as well. We'd made a lot of progress in convincing governments to do it, but now on a practical reality, they're either unwilling or unable to. And so we're in a, you know, again, back to where we were in 2021 and 22, a really worrying place where, according to CENTCOM Commander Carrilla, ISIS has an army in waiting, 10,000 fighters in prisons in northeastern Syria, and its entire next generation in the camps. And this is just totally an unsustainable crisis. And it has to be resolved. Otherwise, we will return to where we were in 2013 and 14. We might not have a big flow of Western fighters or recruits into Syria, but on a local level, the chaos in Syria, the instability, is already providing ISIS with ripe conditions to resurge. But if those prisons were to empty one day down the line, all hell will break loose. And so we have a real responsibility collectively in the international community to try to get this resolved.
And really important work that you're doing on that issue. And it's something, it's one that's important to highlight because people tend to forget about it, including, as you've said, even the regional actors themselves that should be focusing on this. I want to move on to Iraq, as I mentioned earlier. The picture there, as you said at the beginning, looks quite different than it does in Syria. What do you see as the biggest challenges in the anti-ISIS fight there?
Well, the biggest challenge is the fact that ISIS's deepest roots are still in Iraq. No matter how challenging that environment might be for the group today, they still have those links. They still have the Iraqi leadership sort of core that still exists today, albeit much more covertly. And they'll always have those roots and the knowledge gleaned from operating on Iraqi soil. So Iraq continues to face that challenge. There have been subtle signs that the group is making small inroads in northern Iraq, in particular around Kirkuk and Diyala, around that triangle region in northern Iraq. But as I say, you know, even just looking at the operational tempo, it's a shadow of where the group is in Syria. But, you know, a year ago, those of us who were following this very closely and engaging with the US government in particular on it said, well, you should be really, really worried about what ISIS is doing in regime-held Syria, because one day it's going to cross the Euphrates River and affect SDF-held, US-administered region of Syria. That's now happened. Now the next warning is, if this isn't solved on Syrian soil, it will roll over and have a knock-on effect in Iraq, no matter how good or better Iraqi security forces are today as compared to where they were, you know, a decade ago. And they are much better. But at the same time, part of the reason why they are better or at least more able to present a challenge to ISIS is because of the Hashd al-Shaabi, the popular mobilization units. And those present men-at-arms who are able to either deter or to challenge ISIS's ability to resurge in Iraq. But they are also perceived to be a sectarian force. And we know very well from Iraq's more recent history that the perception of sectarianism is ISIS's greatest recruitment tool. And there are very legitimate reasons to be concerned about Hashd al-Shaabi behavior, particularly in Sunni populated areas of the country still to this day, forcefully taking over local businesses and properties. And there's a growing resentment about their presence. And so one day that could become much more of a significant issue. And then lastly, on the Iraqi side of the equation is ongoing US-Iraqi negotiations about the US presence. There was real concern a few months ago that these talks were about to lead to some form of a US withdrawal or significant drawdown. That hasn't come, I think in part because there is now an agreement, even in Baghdad, that there still is an ISIS issue to be concerned about. But perceptions amongst the Hashd al-Shaabi and Iranian proxies that those talks have been stalled by the US, that's the perception, is now giving way to very significant pressure in other directions. And so even just in the last few days, those proxies claim that their ceasefire with the US is over and that they are going to sort of join some region-wide retaliation, not just against Israel, but also against the US. If that happens, you know, we're back to the same place we've been in Syria, which is the US is unable to collect intelligence, operate on the ground, and you know, bring that challenge to ISIS.
If there is a sort of change in the status of the American troop presence in Iraq, the role of the global coalition there, how do you think that's likely to affect the situation on the ground?
Well, I mean, everything is connected. So, I mean, the US plays less of an active role on the ground in Iraq than it does in Syria, but it's still there. But I think for me, the biggest concern is the presence in Syria relies on the presence in Iraq. for logistical reasons, for intelligence, for ISR, for aircraft and airstrikes and what have you. And so if one goes, the other one is at least going to be weakened, if not forced to consider some kind of significant drawdown. There's the possibility that Erbil will replace what happens in Baghdad, but that's a big stretch. And there's, you know, a Turkey dynamic there. Turkey will be very keen to pressure Erbil not to consider that, given other complexities around the US relationship with the SDF and their relationship with the PKK. You know, so everything is connected. Ultimately, the status quo in terms of presence should suit everyone as far as countering ISIS is concerned. But as I say, you know, politics can often raise its ugly head here, and the US presence in Iraq isn't perceived by everybody to just be about countering ISIS. And that's the thorny issue that we're dealing with now.
Finally, I kind of want to turn to the Washington front of things, looking at both U.S. policy specifically, as well as the global coalition itself. As I mentioned at the top of the program, the 10th anniversary of the establishment of the global coalition to defeat ISIS is coming up in September. A decade on, do you think it's still as necessary? And what do you see as its role moving forward?
I honestly actually think there's more of a need for a coalition now than arguably there was back then, in part because the challenge and the threats presented by ISIS today, and not just looking at Syria and Iraq, but globally, are far more interconnected and transnational than they've ever been. You know, back then, the coalition's main purpose was to support the military mission in Syria and Iraq and to liberate all of those territories. But today, there's really a need for an international coalition to share information, to share intelligence, to coordinate actions. Because ISIS has evolved from being a global movement into a really wholesale organization now through a body that it established a few years ago called the General Directorate of Provinces. ISIS has planned attacks in Iran and Russia, plots in southern Europe that are linked from Somalia through the Middle East to Turkey to Central Asia to Afghanistan to Southeast Asia. We're no longer talking about a central leadership in Syria that is planning attacks all around the world. It is genuinely a transnational organization now, with, you know, the Abbey Gate bombing in Kabul back several years ago was financed from Somalia. Recent plots in Spain were financed from the Sahel, from Iraq, Turkey, and Southeast Asia. The interconnectedness here is unprecedented, and it's unlike anything we ever saw from Al-Qaeda. And so now, more than ever, we need that coalition mindset and the sharing of intelligence and the building of trust between governments to be able to counter that much more complex interconnected threat.
And just to clarify for our listeners, we'll be taking a look at some of those other aspects in future episodes of this series, in particular at the situation at the Sahel and the situation with ISKP in South Asia as well. Closer to home here in Washington, the Biden administration is now in its final 5 months in office. Looking back over its time, what has and hasn't it achieved when it comes to dealing with the ISIS threat in Syria and Iraq?
I mean, I would say at best it's achieved the status quo, which is essentially a containment strategy. The Trump administration declared victory when we liberated the last pocket of ISIS territory back in 2019. And whilst everybody who knew anything about anything knew that that victory was way premature, Biden administration's approach to the issue on Syria and Iraq has assumed it was accurate. We haven't changed anything. We haven't followed through. We haven't adapted our approach. We haven't issued any real strategic instruction to DOD in terms of what they do on the ground. And we haven't done anything to more effectively deter some of the distractions and some of the attacks that U.S. troops on the ground have faced, which have had this very real impact on our ability to operate on the ground. So at best, if I'm being generous, they've managed to achieve a status quo approach to the strategy, to the actions. But as I said earlier, that's unsustainable. It's already become unsustainable. We are now starting to see the negative consequences of a status quo approach. It's not enough to just say, I'm willing to support the continued presence of 900 troops in Syria and then leave it at that. There has to be a more strategic approach. At the same time, the Biden administration more quietly within the U.S. government has also sort of been more open to the idea that, well, the inevitable idea that U.S. troops aren't going to be in Syria forever. I think everybody's always known that. But to actually try to game that into strategizing on Syria policy writ large. And so there was there is now a consensus within the US government. A whole of government review was undertaken on Syria and counter-ISIS strategy about a year ago. And that concluded that whatever we're doing in Syria needs to factor in the reality that we are going to have to withdraw one day down the line. Now, it kind of stopped there. The strategy hasn't changed. Syria policy remains virtually non-existent. But even sort of philosophically, that consensus seems to have now emerged. If we go into a Trump administration, God knows what's going to happen next. I think their impetus will be to withdraw. And if we have a Harris administration, I think the impetus will be more status quo. But as I say, it's totally unsustainable. Something's going to have to change.
Before we wrap up, I want to get your kind of final thoughts, your outlook for where you see the kind of ISIS situation going in Syria, Iraq, and any final thoughts you might have.
I suspect we will see ISIS remain relatively low tempo on Iraqi soil for now. Very clear that years ago they made the calculation that their best investments would be in Syria. And there is no reason to believe that the situation in Syria vis-a-vis ISIS is going to get any better. Their operational tempo on a chart may go up and down, but if you average them out, they're clearly going upwards, up the chart. They're clearly increasing their tempo, but much more worrying is those capabilities under the surface. Those are the metrics we need to be using to measure ISIS, not just the attack numbers by themselves. And there's nothing out there to suggest we're willing or politically capable of fixing that issue. And so long as that remains the case, ISIS will grow. And that, you know, draws in Syria more widely. I mean, Syria is total chaos. There is no resolution to the Syrian crisis. Nobody seems to be determined to try to resolve the crisis. The humanitarian situation is dramatically worsening month on month, whilst international donors to the humanitarian response are reducing month on month. At the moment, the UN only has 15% of the funds that it needs to meet the minimum humanitarian needs in Syria. And so when you're talking about terrorist organizations, they are always going to reap the benefits of situations like that. And so it's very sad to say that the outlook is deeply, deeply negative, and there's really no light at the end of the tunnel in terms of hoping for that to change.
It's a sobering picture, but we'll have to leave things there for now with that. But Charles, thank you very much for joining the podcast.
Thanks for having me.
That's all the time we have for this week. Thank you to our listeners for tuning in and to our podcast editor, Elliot Sanders, for all of his work on this week's episode. You can find all of MEI's latest coverage of regional issues, Syria and ISIS, on our website at www.mei.edu. And you can follow MEI on X, Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube, and subscribe to our email newsletters for the latest analysis and information about upcoming events. I'm Alistair Taylor. We will see all of you next week.
This has been a presentation of the Middle East Institute. To support MEI's programs and podcasts, please donate at www.mei.edu. Thank you for your support.